These are the members of some of the members of the BRCA research team at Dana-Farber Cancer Institute. Our institution is very proud for our basic translational and clinical research, and as well as discoveries in the field of BRCA biology and BRCA mutated cancers. And our center was launched to continue this tradition and also bring together basic translational and clinical scientists working on different cancer types and different disciplines. Our vision is to improve the survival and quality of life of patients and family members with inherited and acquired mutations in cancer, grow our exemplary care of patients and families with inherited and acquired mutations and cancers, strengthen collaboration by promoting interdisciplinary and interdisease clinical translational and basic research in the field of BRCA-related cancers, incorporate novel technologies and advances into early detection, risk reduction, and treatment of BRCA cancers, stimulate further investigation into biology and evolution of BRCA-related cancers, and last but not least, support career growth, enhance career opportunities, and support junior faculty and investigators from different disciplines to work in this area. We aim to bring together experts from multiple research areas, from BRCA biology, computational biology, chemical biology, all the way to developmental therapeutics, clinical research, and clinical trials, all channeled into three main focus areas: treatment, risk reduction, and early detection. In terms of treatment, we try to develop a robust target and drug discovery platform. We aim to actively engage in preclinical and clinical evaluation of novel therapies, and also understand and overcome drug resistance. And this is particularly drug resistance that relates to PARP inhibitor resistance is a major problem for our patients. And there are a number of mechanism of PARP inhibitor resistance. Some of them are highlighted in this slide. Some of them were actually described here at Dana-Farber. And trying to understand resistance and how to overcome it is a major focus of our center. It's really not an overstatement to say that, I'm sorry, how can I get this off? It's not an overstatement to say that since the development of PARP inhibitors, there has been really a true revolution in terms of the development of novel DNA repair agents. So these include DNA damage signaling inhibitors, DNA repair pathway inhibitors, DNTP metabolic enzyme inhibitors, novel synthetic lethal approaches. Those agents are in various stages of preclinical and clinical development. I'm sure you're going to hear about many of those agents and targets today. And we are aiming to be actively involved in the preclinical and clinical evaluation of these agents, and most importantly, try to provide those agents in patients through our patients through clinical trial participation. In terms of risk reduction and prevention, Dr. Judy Garber is leading efforts regarding cancer risk reduction in BRCA1/2 carriers. She's launching early phase biomarker modulation prevention studies in BRCA1/2 carriers. And in collaboration with Dr. Alan DeAndrea, myself and other investigators, we're looking at preclinical testing of novel therapeutics to prevent ovarian and breast carcinogenesis. We're also very excited about our early detection efforts in this area, using multi-omic approaches to early detection of BRCA-related cancers. Dr. Chowdhury, Dr. Elias, and Dr. Garber have launched a study looking into circulating microRNAs, the microRNA detection study that is evaluating circulating tumor microRNAs as serum microRNAs as a screening test for ovarian cancer in healthy BRCA mutation carriers. We're also aiming to establish a large precursor lesion biobank to facilitate BRCA-related early detection and prevention. We want to recognize the generosity of our donors who have made significant foundational gifts to the Center for BRCA and Related Genes, the funds from which have helped us launch several key components and have accelerated our research progress. So after these introductory comments, and without further ado, we will proceed with a morning session, session one of their agenda. The afternoon session will be chaired by Dr. Jeff Shapiro. And at the end, we will have a panel discussion with all the speakers present here that will be chaired by Dr. Alan DeAndrea. For those attending virtually, I encourage you to send any questions in the chat. And although we will not be answering those questions in the chat, we will try to address as many of them at the end of the panel, at the time of the panel discussion. Right now, it is my distinct pleasure to introduce today's keynote speaker, Professor Daniel Durocher. Dan received his Bachelor in Science in the University of Montreal, his PhD in McGill University, and did his postdoc at the University of Cambridge in the United Kingdom. He is the Tom Kearns Research Chair in Mechanisms of Cancer Development at the Lunenfeld-Tannenbaum Research Institute and Mount Sinai Hospital at Toronto, Ontario, and at the Department of Molecular Genetics, University of Toronto. He holds the Canada Chair, Research Chair in the Molecular Genetics of the DNA Damage Response, and was awarded the prestigious 2016 Paul Marx Prize in Cancer Research. His laboratory is studying DNA repair, DNA replication, and cell cycle checkpoints. Among many accomplishments, Dan has made fundamental contribution into our understanding of the role of 53BP1, RNF8, and of the shielding complex into DNA repair. He's also well known on his work employing CRISPR-Cas9-based synthetic lethality screens to uncover novel therapeutic targets for anti-cancer therapy, such as identification of inhibition of PKMYT1 kinase against cyclin E-amplified tumors, or of CYP2A against BRCA deficient cells, as well as to identify dependencies on DNA damage repair inhibitors, such as genetic vulnerabilities to ATR inhibition. Dan, the floor is yours.
Okay, yes. Thank you so much, Panas. We need to do a little switcheroo of my presentation. But so I'll start by first thanking the organizers of this really nice symposium. It's always a pleasure to come back to Boston. It's basically a suburb of Toronto by plane. although we had snow last night, which delayed a little bit my flights. So what I'm going to talk to you today, actually, I'll start with a little introduction on where I see a bit of the field going in terms of synthetic lethality and HR deficiency. And then I'll focus on a story where we discovered a very profound synthetic lethal interaction between a factor that was mentioned by Panos, CYP2A, and BRCA1 and BRCA2 deficiency. And I will update you on the work we're doing on this thing. Okay, great. Thank you so much, Evie. So as mentioned by Panas, really the canonical role of the BRCA1, BRCA2 tumor suppressors is to collaborate in a DNA repair pathway called homologous recombination, or HR. And BRCA1 in combination with its cognate interacting protein, BARD1, acts at the first step of the HR pathway to promote basically end resection, which is the formation of single-stranded DNA. I'll try to put my, yes, that's gonna be good for the people online. And the formation of the single-stranded DNA that is basically the intermediate for homology search and strand invasion during the HR process. BRCA1 also participates in the recruitment of BRCA2 and PALB2. And these two proteins, this protein complex, basically acts as the recombinase mediator that basically catalyzed the exchange of RPA, which binds to single-stranded DNA, to the active nucleophilament filament bound by RAD51. And this is what is the business end of the HR pathway that will do homology search and invasion and assemble the complexes that lead to the homologous copying.
Dan, I'm so sorry. Would you mind sharing your screen?
Sorry.
Because I don't think that we can show people.
Okay.
Let's see.
Right.
And then we have to do like a
slideshow here. That should work too.
Sorry,
on the top, because that cuts all the guidance.
Maybe one.
All right. Awesome.
All right, we're ready.
Okay, so in addition to this canonical role of BRCA1, BRCA2, and HR, I think it's quite clear that the BRCA1, BRCA2 proteins also play a role in promoting the fidelity of DNA replication. I think we'll hear from Sharon later today that it's really interesting observation our lab has made that BRCA2 and BRCA1 prevent the accumulation of single-stranded DNA gaps in response to PARP inhibition. In addition, the BRCA2, and that's something that I think is often forgotten, is that the BRCA1 and BRCA2 genes themselves are cell essential genes, okay? And what's clear is that if you acutely inactivate BRCA1 and BRCA2, as shown here in this really interesting study by Mary Jason's lab, what you see is an accumulation of problems that are seen especially during cell division, during mitosis, okay? So it seems that BRCA1, BRCA2, one of its main function, at least in the context of cellular fitness, is probably to promote DNA replication in a way that the whole genome is duplicated at the time of cell division, okay? So, and that's going to be relevant for the talk today, is that BRCA deficient cells have mitotic DNA damage. Okay. And that's actually probably a vulnerability that can be exploited. The other implication from this is that BRCA1, BRCA2 mutated cells must overcome this cellular lethality. And this was called the BRCA paradox in a very interesting essay by Steve Ellich and a few years ago. So the consequence of BRCA1 and BRCA2 loss is genome instability. And I think now there's a lot of genetic whole genome sequencing data that really characterize the patterns of genome instability associated with BRCA deficiency. And that includes single nucleotide variants, changes, indels, and large scale deletions and rearrangements. Obviously, the question, as also raised by panelists, is that this must come with some collateral vulnerabilities, and we know it does. And really, an effort from my lab has been really, how do we prospectively find these vulnerabilities? And I think also for us, because we're a basic scientist lab, is what can we learn from this, okay, in terms of genome maintenance mechanism? And this is really where the story is. So really, we know there are vulnerabilities because there's this really poster child of vulnerabilities in HR deficiency, which is the really exciting, profound, and translated vulnerability of BRCA deficient cells to PARP inhibition. And this really establishes that synthetic lethality in cancer therapy can be pursued as a modality. So BRCA1 and BRCA2 are DNA repair factors, and so is PARP 1 and 2. And they act at various aspects of in various DNA repair processes. But one of its main functions is to act in promoting single-strand break repair or base excision repair. And what happens when you inhibit PARP is that you get accumulation of single-stranded DNA lesions and single-stranded DNA gaps. And these basically need to be taken care of by HR-dependent BRCA 1 and 2. So in this case here, and that's a point I want to make, is that when we look at synthetic lethality with DNA repair deficiency, okay, we're exploiting endogenous DNA damage fundamentally in many cases, okay? So of course we can induce the synthetic lethality by adding genotoxic agents, but fundamentally at the genetic level, synthetic lethal interactions between a DNA repair, a defect in a DNA repair genes and another genes means that we're looking at endogenous DNA damage problem. So why look for more synthetic lethal targets with IHR deficiency? I think my personal opinion is that PARP inhibitors is really just the beginning of this story. And I think, I imagine there's the Center for BRCA also would agree with me here. And we think that new targets have the potential of treating some form of PARP inhibitor resistance. They can be used as monotherapy or combination in disease settings where the outcome of PARP inhibitor treatment could be improved, pancreatic cancer, prostate cancer, for example. They may have distinct safety profiles that allow for different combination potential for higher quality of life for our patients. I think that's important to think about. And also they might actually have their own synthetic lethal networks outside HR deficiency that might allow you to address different set of patients. So I think there's a lot of reasons why we want to go and find these targets. So I think this is a slide kind of similar to what Panos has mentioned, and I think that illustrates that we have overlapping and distinct sets of agents that we think are in development. And that tells you how active this field is. I think probably the most exciting one at the moment is really our PARP selective, PARP1 selective inhibitors, such as the one developed by AstraZeneca, and there are many more in development, I hear. The ATR inhibitors, there are many of them, and they're actually showing some very interesting clinical activity in BRCA deficient, in BRCA deficient patients, including in patients that have reversion mutations. So the Pol Theta inhibitors now have entered the clinic. The RTOS inhibitors is currently in phase one, and they're about to start phase two, and there are others, including the agent that Allen's lab has developed, which I think is being investigated here at the Dana-Farber. PARG inhibitors, UXP1 inhibitors also, which Allen's lab has made nice contributions to, are in development. And there are many others that are likely. And this is my list here, and maybe we'll hear from the LC1 from Roger later on as well. So many contributions from the people in this crowd. Okay, so what I want to talk to you really is what is the best quote unquote synthetic lethal interaction with BRCA1? So what would you have done if you had done kind of a synthetic lethal screen 30 years ago? Okay, which one would you have picked? Obviously, history would have told you that PARP probably would have been the one you should have picked, but maybe not after looking at the data I'm going to show you. Okay, so what we're going to look at is really trying to find a highly penetrant synthetic lethal interaction. I think obviously we want to address the largest patient population possible. Also, something that there's a lot of synthetic lethal interaction nominated in the literature, but they all have different phenotypic strengths. So we want something that's very strong. And actually, also, we probably want something that is differentiated from PARP inhibition. We don't want to just go to the same well as we've been going with PARP inhibitor because we want to have a distinct profile. So what we've done a few years ago, and that was really transformative for our lab, is really trying to adopt and really exploit the ability of using genome scale somatic screens using CRISPR-based knockouts. Okay. So this is our approach. So we've done two different screens in two different cell lines, different backgrounds. One screen using a BRCA1 mutation, and the other screen is doing a BRCA2 mutation. And really our idea was to find synthetic lethal interactions that were common to both. The way we do our screens is using isogenic screens, where basically we profile two cell lines that differ by one genetic alteration, in this case, BRCA1 or BRCA2 mutations. And the idea here is to identify genes whose knockout is lethal in the BRCA deficient cell line, but viable in the normal isogenic control cell. And we use various algorithms to really prioritize this. So this is the outcome of the screens here. So I'm showing you basically on the y-axis, the BRCA2 screen, and on the x-axis, the BRCA1 screen. And basically, the bigger the number, the more synthetic lethal the gene is in this population. So we had around 10 genes that score very strongly in both of these cell lines. And some of them you will recognize, such as PARP1. So that already told us that our screen is actually good at finding what's known. And also identify a number of genes, including ALC1 or CHD1L, that may be discussed later by Roger. We also found genes that participate in base excision repair or single strand breaks, such as APOIN1. But we actually then took this list and asked a question, okay, so this is what's done in isogenic cell lines. What about in tumor-derived cell lines? Okay, which are these genes we should look at or show a signal in tumor-derived cell lines? And to do this, we basically took advantage of the wonderful resource that's being built at the Broad Institute and the Sanger Center called the dependency. Wow, French Canadian words sometimes are difficult in English. A dependency map. Basically, we asked the questions: if we separate all the cell lines in BRCA deficient or mutated versus wild type, do we see a difference in essentiality that corresponds to statistically significant differences? So basically, out of our roughly 10 genes, there were two that came up in the signal, and that doesn't mean the other genes are not truly synthetic lethal. It just means that we didn't get the signal in the depth map using this analysis. Just want to emphasize that. We had two genes that came up as strongly positive, showing a really selective essentiality. The first one was APEX2, which I'll briefly mention in a minute. And the other one that showed actually the strongest dependency is CYP2A. So we actually worked on both of these. APEX2 encodes a gene called APE2, and that's a nuclease. And what we discovered is that APE2 acts to protect cells from endogenous tree prime blocking lesions. Tree prime blocking lesions are really problematic because the way cells synthesize DNA is from tree prime to 5 prime, so it needs a free tree prime end for DNA synthesis. And these lesions will accumulate particularly in response to problems associated with topoisomerase 1 and also the removal of embedded ribonucleotides in DNA, which turns out to be a very common problem in cells. So APE2 basically acts to rescue and reverse these lesions. And it turns out that in the absence of APE2, you really, kind of as a last resort, you need the HR pathway. So this type of synthetic lethal interaction, it's kind of similar in concept to PARP synthetic lethality, in the sense that APE2 prevents the accumulation of lesions that then require HR, okay? So it's in that class. So looking back at CYP2A, and that's really where I'm gonna spend most of my time here. So I just want to show you that this is really a true synthetic lethal interaction, in the sense that loss of CYP2A in most cell lines basically is completely innocuous, okay? There's actually very little impact on fitness shown here. Okay. However, if you remove CYP2A in a BRCA1 or BRCA2 deficient cell, you basically wipe out the clonogenic potentials of these cells. Okay. Very strong synthetic lethality. So what is CYP2A? Well, CYP2A is a protein that was primarily investigated due to its potential role as a modulator of protein phosphatase 2A. It's an armadillo repeat protein that forms this core, folded core here. And then the second half of the protein is basically a long coiled core domain. There was excitement about studying CYP2A because it's actually overexpresses a number of malignancies. Yes, it forms a dimer. And that's basically just about it, what we know about CYP2A. So I really wanted to ask the question, what type of synthetic lethality did we deal with here? Is this same phenomenon as endogenous lesion repair, i.e. Like PARP or A2? So these are, is it a gene that prevents the formation of endogenous DNA lesions that need to be dealt with by BRCA? Or actually, is it more kind of an adaptive mechanism in the sense that it's actually dealing with lesions that accumulate as a consequence of BRCA1 and 2 deficiency? Okay. So really, the way to test that is relatively simple. Can we actually look at DNA lesions that engage the HR pathway? And are these elevated in the absence of CYP2A? So for example, if you treat cells with PARP inhibitors, you will see increased levels of RAD51 foci because there's more HR, okay? And that's basically what we ask. So are there increased numbers of RAD51 foci as a measure of spontaneous HR in CYP2A deficient cells? So these I need to mention, these are HR proficient CYP2A deficient cells. And as you can see here, actually no, if anything, there's a little less RAD51 foci, okay? So it doesn't seem to, loss of CYP2A doesn't seem to engage HR by itself. And then we looked at it in a different way, which is basically an HR reaction, which is sister chromatid exchanges. And here again, loss of CYP2A, either under normal condition or stimulated by PARP inhibitors, does not impact sister chromatid exchanges. Okay, so this is really telling us that CYP2A acts in a way that is distinct from PARP inhibitors, in the sense that it doesn't cause endogenous DNA lesions. So really, our big break here came when we looked at micronuclei. We were actually a little bit lost, and we decided to kind of step back and monitor micronuclei, which is a really good surrogate for genomic instability in cells and in tumors and in tissues. So micronuclei really forms as a consequence of missegregation of either whole or broken chromosomes. There's basically two different flavors of micronuclei, those that occur due to a missegregation of chromosomes or are caused by basically the segregation of eccentric chromosome fragments. So if you break chromosomes in mitosis, there'll be a bit of the chromosome that is not attached to the spindle. So it has the opportunity maybe to float to basically the wrong daughter, okay? And we can differentiate between these two flavors just by looking at kinetochores, so or centromeres, because this type caused by breaks basically will be centromere negative. The other thing that, and you know, this audience probably is very familiar with this, given the presence of David Pellman at the Dana-Farber, is that micronuclei promote rapid genome evolution, and also they probably act as an alert system for innate immunity to say there's genome instability. So there's a lot of interest in micronuclei. So what we found is that disrupting CYP2A in BRCA deficient cell led to really striking increase in micronucleation, specifically in the BRCA deficient setting. And this was basically almost entirely due to eccentric chromosome missegregation, so broken chromosomes. And so this is this, I want you to hold this result, because actually it's a very important piece of information. So in parallel to this, as also panelists mentioned, we've been involved in basically mapping the genetic architectures of the response to genotoxic agents. And we published a few years ago, basically our kind of first iteration of this study. And CYP2A actually came up as a hit in a number of screens, including ATR inhibitor, okay? And so CYP2A deficient cells are very sensitive to ATR inhibitor. And we think the reason for this is that CYP2A likely deals with underreplicated DNA, okay? And this is an example here. So if we take CYP2A deficient cells and look at the formation of micronuclei, we add a little bit, very small dose of a DNA replication inhibitor, acetylcholine, or ATR inhibitor would really increase micronucleation in these cells, really suggesting that perturbing DNA replication really subtly causes the problem in CYP2A deficient cells. And also, I changed my slide and I realized I didn't tell you where CYP2A localizes first, but I'll go back to that in a minute. But we have evidence that CYP2A acts with mitotic DNA lesions, and I'll go back to that in a minute. Okay, so this is the model we have for the CYP2A BRCA synthetic lethal interaction. Has been described before by a number of groups, is loss of BRCA1, BRCA2 leads to incomplete DNA replication. This leads to chromatid breakage and mitosis. I didn't show you the data, but this is also a very strong phenotype. And basically, CYP2A prevents something at this step basically avoid the misaggregation of broken chromosome, which we think is probably a key feature of the death that we're seeing. Obviously, how does it work? So again, this was a kind of really vexing problem because we really felt CYP2A had to be a DNA repair factor or be involved in DNA damage response due to the phenotypes. But CYP2A, there are very, very good antibodies against CYP2A that exist, and shown here, you see the knockout, the immunofluorescence signal is completely gone. So CYP2A is a cytoplasmic protein. So this was really problematic. to act on nuclei DNA, then we ask the question, well, how about we treat with a bucket of a load of DNA lesions? Do we see actually localization of CYP2A to the damaged site? Actually, the answer is no. So in interphase, CYP2A is basically cytoplasmic and stays cytoplasmic. However, my postdoc Salome Adam, who was working on this, actually noticed that actually some cells in the field showed CYP2A foci, and it was basically this cell here, okay, that colocalized with gamma H2X. And actually, if you're a little bit of a cell biologist, it won't take you long to realize that this is actually a mitotic cell. So CYP2A can localize to sites of DNA damage, can only do so in mitotic cells. And basically it responds to ionizing radiation and other DNA damage. Shown here, we see really increased number of CYP2A in mitotic cells. But the other important point to mention is that spontaneous mitotic CYP2A foci are also increased in BRCA deficient cells. Okay, and actually something that I know it's difficult to look at mitotic figures in tumors, but one thing I really would like someone to look at some point is to look at CYP2A maybe as a potential marker for HR deficiency, because actually it's a very striking phenotype. So this mitotic DNA damage localization of CYP2A may be relevant to this synthetic lethality. And basically this is something we wanted to explore. So more from a mechanistic basis, we discovered that CYP2A forms a complex with another DNA damage response factor called TOPBP1. TOPBP1 is a protein that has been around the field for a long time because it has this really interesting property to be an adapter protein. It consists of a 9 BRCT domain, which are possible peptide recognition modules. So it basically interact with proteins in a possible and most a number of proteins using phosphate dependent recognition, such as FANG-J. Charon also worked on. It is able to bind FANG-J, phosphorylated FANG-J, but it interacts with a whole slew of proteins. And I'm going to skip some work here, but what we showed is that the localization of CYP2A in mitotic cells basically occurs via two independent pathways. One pathway is basically in response to clear DNA double-strand breaks, such as those that are caused by ionizing radiation. And this is a pathway that is dependent on the protein called MDC1, which is basically the reader of phosphorylated H2AX. And then there's another pathway that seems to be occurring in response to under-replicated DNA. And we don't know actually what's acting upstream of CYP2WB1. It's a very active area in the lab at the moment. So just to show you that C2 co-localizes with BP1 in mitotic cells, this is an image from our collaborator in Manuel Stuckey's lab, and this is the perfect color combination. So CYP2A and BP1 perfectly co-localize on mitotic DNA lesions. So I need also to mention that it's not only that they co-localize together, they're interdependent with each other. So loss of CYP2A causes loss of BP1 localization and vice versa. And also, as kind of hinted before, things CYP2A and FOSI are excellent and selective marker of mitotic DNA lesions. And I encourage you all to use it because it is a very very good antibodies. So this understand or partial understanding of what's upstream of CYP2A and BP1 allowed us to ask the question of which one of these pathways is relevant to synthetic lethality. And basically what we found is that it's not the known pathway. it's something like this. It's not MDC1. So MDC1 cells, MDC1 deficiency is not lethal in BRCA, in our isogenic BRCA cell lines. It's probably this response to under-replicated DNA, which probably makes sense in retrospect. So, Mac to Windows conversion issue here. We basically wanted to go and really validate the idea that it was this complex that was acting to promote viability in BRCA division cells. So we needed first to map the interaction. So we decided to look primarily, and BP1 is an essential gene. So we cannot just delete BP1. So we decided to go and map the interaction site on BP1 and mutate it so that we can ask the question, is this complex formation important? Okay. Basically, we identified a conserved region, which is actually lies between BRCT5 and BRCT6. It's actually a highly conserved region in BP1. And we identified a number of residues that are important for the interaction. So we have this allele called the 3A alleles. And basically, if we disrupt the interaction between CYP2A and BP1, we lose the ability of both proteins to localize to sites of mitotic DNA damage. So that gives us the opportunity to ask a question, is it important for the viability? So just showing you the data in BRCA2 deficient cells, I'm introducing this 3A mutation. So we're using a gene replacement system where we put in the 3A mutant and then remove the endogenous BP1. Removing BP1 is essential in all cell lines, so cells are not able to grow. We put back BP1, it's all good, and the wild type, the 3A mutant is fine, but it's actually lethal in the BRCA2 mutated cells. So the complex is important for the viability. And I'm not showing you, but it causes micronucleation as well as one would expect. So can we push this a little further? Can we actually establish a kind of a therapeutic proof of concept? So what we need to find is an inhibitor of this interaction, okay? We don't have a chemical inhibitor of this interaction, sadly. But by serendipity, we found a small version of BP1, which basically acts as a very potent dominant negative. Okay, we call this BCL because it's the left side of BRCT6, very creative way to name it. So we have a system where we can induce the expression of this B6L peptide. And when we induce the expression of B6L, we get a very rapid loss of mitotic DNA DNA damage localization of CYP2A and BP1. Okay, so this is a great tool. And induced stabilization or induced expression of B6Ls really impairs BRCA2 deficient cell growth. And actually, I'm not showing you the data here, but this growth arrest is irreversible. So if we induce it for a few hours, actually we induce it for 24 hours and then stop the expression of B6L, the cells cannot recover. So it's a kind of a terminal phenotype. So we wanted to look in vivo in BRCA deficient tumors. And this was in collaboration with Repair Therapeutics. What we found is that expressing CYP2A, the B6L fragment, so disrupting this interaction, led to profound tumor growth inhibition. Okay, and this is actually remarkable because the pharmacokinetic of the expression is very poor. So we're able to get expression of B6L around 4 hours per day in this model at levels that are higher than the IC50. So a very transient and periodic stabilization of CYP2A can lead to a very profound tumor growth inhibition. I can tell you this is as good or better than whole data inhibition in this model. So our model for the synthetic lethality is this one, as I mentioned. We think that CYP2A top BP1 prevents micronucleation by promoting either the repair or the segregation of eccentric chromatin fragments. In fact, we think that the most likely function for top BP1 is CYP2A is to basically act as a physical tether that keeps the eccentric chromosome fragment with the centromere-bearing chromosome, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And this actually, this chromosome tether has been really long sought after. There's some evidence of one existing in Drosophila and in budding yeast, but in human cells, we have no idea where this tether is or was. Do I have a couple more minutes?
Yeah.
I'm doing good? Okay.
Great.
So I'll go now a little bit more new data here. So now we're very interested in understanding what are the potential roles of this chromosome tether. So this is actually a slide, a figure coming from a recent paper from Marcel van Voet, and there's versions of that Johannes Walter and David Pellman have generated. So it looks like when cells enter mitosis with under-replicated DNA, it needs to activate pathways that will basically separate the chromatids together. Okay, and we know that, for example, the trait E3 ligase is one of the activities that will do this. But what work from David and Johannes has shown is that in addition to this, cells activate nucleases that will basically generate DNA double strand break in mitosis. Now the question is, what happens? What is the fate of these breaks? And there's a number of possibilities, but one possibility is that this activates basically a microhomology mediated end joining. So there might be a role for pol theta in this pathway. So obviously top BP1 and CYP2A could act at multiple points in this pathway. It may promote mitotic double-strand break repair by pol theta, or it may promote directed segregation of the broken chromatids so that it's the broken chromatids might go to the right daughter cells, and then allowing it to be repaired by end joining, probably in the next cell cycle. I think there's some data that doesn't come from our lab, but that are very exciting and were recently posted on BioArchive. So from the lab of Peter Lee in Dallas and Don Cleveland's lab, that really suggests that reinforces the idea that CYP2A and top BP1 might be a chromosome tether mitosis. And this is this arose from a really interesting question that both labs have asked is we know these micronuclei get produced from missegregated chromosome segregation. And we also know that micronuclei basically becomes disrupted in a very high rate in interface cells. And when a micronuclei becomes disrupted, they accumulate DNA double strand breaks. So the question that both Peter and Don's lab have asked is what happens to these broken micronuclei when you go to the next mitosis, okay? Are they segregating together en masse, or are they basically disrupted and the micronuclear fragments, go each on their own way in a random dispersed fashion? What they both reported was that actually, micronuclear derived chromosome fragments in mitosis are basically kept together and they are segregated together in a way that depends on the CYP2A top BP1 complex. Okay. And this is just one of they have a really nice system to look at this, and they get a very, very strong phenotype of micronuclear fragment disruption when CYP2A is removed from cells. So this is a very strong indication that CYP2A topping 1 acts as a chromosome better, but it doesn't really exclude yet completely that it doesn't also play a role in promoting double-strand break repair of mitosis. Okay, the last couple of minutes, I just want to answer another question, which is what is upstream and downstream? And this is really where a lot of our activity is focused. And basically, we decided to look at this problem from the side of TUBBP1, okay? We asked if CYP2A interacts with TUBBP1, and TUBBP1 is a scaffold, maybe it's interacting with another factor that is important for this pathway. And TUBBP1 has multiple BRCT domains. So we basically asked a question, is there any of these BRCT domains essential selectively in BRCA-deficient cells? Is it actually, can we find synthetic lethality between BRCT domain mutation in TUBBP1 and CYP2A? So Ivo, postdoc in the lab, generated mutants of all the BRCT domains. As control, we have 3A mutations that disrupt CYP2A binding and express them in cell lines, and then remove the endogenous TUBBP1. And basically, the data is shown here. And what he's first, he screened them by looking at micronucleation. So the idea here is to find conditions where micronucleation is not increased in the wild type cell lines, but is increased in the BRCA deficient cells. And what he found is that, well, the first, the positive control is this 3A mutant here. You see that it's low in the wild type and high in the BRCA2 deficient cells. And basically, we found only one other mutation that had a very similar profile, and it's this mutation here in BRCT7. Here, okay. So in addition, he was then able to again ask the question, is BRCT7, so this is a mutation that only disrupts phosphopeptide binding, is it essential in BRCA2 deficient cells? And as you can see here, it's not essential in the wild type setting, and it's completely essential in the BRCA2 deficient cells. So there's a synthetic lethality between BRCT7 and 8, so they work as a tandem and BRCA deficiency. Then actually the big surprise for us is that asking the question is actually impacting CYP2A and TUBBP1 localization. So it has the same phenotype in terms of synthetic lethality as CYP2A or deficiency. But what we found is that this mutation, unlike the 3A mutation, does not impact CYP2A or TUBBP1 localization. Okay, so what it says is that BRCT7 and 8 acts downstream of CYP2A. Okay, so basically, what we identified is evidence of a factor that is basically acting downstream of this complex. So for us, this is very exciting because it suggests that there might be a pathway at play here, where there are other effectors of this pathway situated. So what I showed you is that we used BRCA synthetic lethality screens to explore what I think is completely unexplored or very poorly explored biology, which is how do cells deal with broken chromosomes in mitosis, okay? So this is kind of a really interesting side story from the synthetic lethality story. So now we're very excited about trying to find the identity of protein X. We know it's probably not FANG J. And we're really interested in understanding what are the biochemical activities associated with this pathway. And obviously we're also interested in understanding what's the physiological role of this pathway in organisms. So this work was initiated by Salome Adan and Sylvia Rossi. They both, Salome is left the lab, and Sylvia sadly passed away from AML last year. This work is being continued by two postdocs in the lab, Yibo Jue and Faisal Bin Rashed. We had lots of help from many people. Over the year, I just want to highlight the help of Manuel Stuckey and Repair Therapeutics, and these are our founders. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dan. We actually have some time for some questions. So, Roger?
Really nice work, Dan. I'm wondering your thoughts on what is the lesion being recognized? Because if there's a synthetic lethality with a low dose of fitocholine where there shouldn't be a lot of double-stranded breaks, it suggests that there is some protection against an additional processing event that then leads to acentric fragments that get into the micronuclei. And so have you looked for anything that suppresses this phenotype? And low-dose ofidocoline might be the cleanest or the easiest way to do it, where there wouldn't be a mix of double-strand breaks and other patients.
Yeah, so this is a very good question. So, and you know, in many ways, it probably, so we don't know exactly where in that series of events the 2 and WP1 work. And I think you raise a really good possibility is that it may somehow be preloaded somehow on replication ports that enter mitosis, so that in some ways it's keeping everything together at once, or it might be involved in the processing or preventing the processing itself. We actually don't know really how, you know, we don't have any evidence either way what's going on, but this is a very important question that we want to address. And we love genetic screens, and we're doing very similar screens as you, you're proposing to really kind of trying to address this question. But I think that's a big question we need to look at.
Dr. Palmer?
Awesome. So I think you made an extremely convincing case that CYP2A TOPBP1 is holding ends together. And my question is sort of an invitation to speculate on who really is doing the bulk of the repair of the joining event. So, you know, one obvious candidate is Paul Beta, but during mitosis, you only have about 30 minutes or so for it to do something. So the question is the repair happening in mitosis? Is this being carried over into interphase? And then vis-a-vis the relevance of CYP2A to chromothripsis, at least from the sequence of the junctions and the degree of microhomology in chromothripsis, we kind of think that most of the ends are being joined by classic end joining. So I'm curious to know whether you think one or the other, and whether there's any dependency on non-homologous end joining to rectify the defects of lacking CYP2A.
Yeah, I think this, you're probably summarizing my thoughts, which is, I think due to the small window of time to act on these DNA lesions and mitosis, that, you know, I'm not excluding that it may not participate in fixing a few of them in mitosis, but the bulk will be in the next G1, probably by kind of call end joining. So that would be my, if I have to speculate, you know, and as you know, a lot of the studies that look at, you know, are attempting to look at double-strand break repair in mitosis, basically are holding cells in mitosis for a very long time. So they're not really, you're not really capturing what actually is happening in an unperturbed mitosis. So
I think that's the most intuitive thing, but then how do you explain why CYP2A and Pol Theta are such beautiful codependencies in DepMap?
Well, I think they're beautiful codependencies because both have synthetic lethality. You also get A2 as a really nice codependency in that map with so I think it's simply because they are synthetic lethal BRCA, and that's the main signal that drives the correlation in that map. Where I was very interested in looking at the relationship with Pol Theta, as many of you know, there's a lot of exciting work linking Pol Theta activity in mitosis, and that was kind of started by your studies with UNS. You know, Pol Theta does look like to damage sites in mitosis, and there seems to be interesting biology there. So far, you know, our data suggests that certainly Pol Theta is not upstream of CYP2A. We've not been able yet to look at the other way around. But I think that's my speculation.
Do you see codependency with other genes in the MMEJ pathway that, you know, that David was just referring to, or is it just Pol Theta?
So there's data suggesting that Rhino might be participating in the MMEJ pathway, and we definitely see Rhino being a codependency. Yeah.
So Dan, again, I do want to acknowledge that Marcus Lawbridge is visiting us. He's with us, so he did this, you know, beautiful work on Pol Theta and mitosis. So my question is a little different from the ATR perspective. So the synthetic lethality that you're seeing with CYP20 or BP1, so we know TOP-BP1 has ATR independent roles, particularly MIDAS and all that. So do you think that CYP2A ATR sensitivity is also due to mitotic issues, or is that CYP2A has some other role?
Yes. Yeah, actually. So thanks.
Could it affect the G2M by affecting the B2A? Very relevant
yes.
to this. I mean, do you know we
yeah.
want levels?
Okay, and... yes. So there's two questions here. So first question, which is the easiest because I have a slide on it. It really is this interaction also pertinent for ATR sensitivity. So we express that B6L fragment in cells and ask, do we actually cause ATR sensitivity? And we do, okay? Then the other experiments, and that's what's shown here. Then the other, it's not here, I didn't put it in. But the other experiment is that if we hold cells in G2, okay, we completely suppress for a certain amount of time, we completely suppress the ATR-dependent micronucleation and or the acetylcholine-dependent micronucleation in CYP2A-deficient cells. So this is telling me that what CYP2A does is that it deals with lesions that are spillover from S phase into mitosis, okay? You know, the relationship with some mitotic process such as MIDAS or, you know, ultrafine chromosome bridges, it actually seems a complicated one in the sense that you can see CYP2A in each of these processes kind of acting, but it doesn't seem to be required for them, nor is in all of these events at the same, you know, in all the cells. So that's something we're trying to work out. Regarding the G2M checkpoint, we've not looked at it. What we've looked at is whether or not the PP2A, the relationship with CYP2A was important. And so far, we have no evidence to suggest that this interaction is irrelevant in this case. So, but that, you know, they're all experiments with a number of caveats. So we don't have a definitive answer, but so far our data really strongly suggests that it's the PP2A interaction, which actually is an inhibition of PP2A. So it is not related to that. So I think really it's a mitotic specific issue.
So you propose the CYP2A and the TOP-BP1 hold the broken chromosome arm together. So which one of these two proteins can strongly bind the two chromatin?
So it clearly we need to bring it up with something. Okay. So there's clearly has to be an upstream factor that comes in. So I would say it's that obviously on one side it's MDC1 through its interaction with H2AX.
Hmm.
On the other side, we're still looking for it. We, you know, we can speculate, and we think that's probably going to be something related to the replication. And there are a number of replication machinery components that interact with TOP-BP1. So this is an area we're looking at. There's a lot of very curious things that we see with, and I don't really have time. So CYP2A TOP-BP1 seems to be forming filaments in certain settings. And we're very curious to know whether or not the ability to form filaments actually create basically a physical tether between chromosomes. And this is, we know that the follicle region of CYP2A is essential in BRCA deficient cells. So that really suggests that large scale assemblies of these complexes will be important. But I think we're now, you know, doing biochemistry to really kind of try to answer some of these questions. But yeah, there needs to be something that anchors it to the chromosome. I get that, and we're looking for it. Yeah.
Does this B6L inhibits the TOP-BP1 localization to like RAP911 complex ATR?
No, because it's really select. It actually doesn't affect ATR signaling, and because it's really essentially just a CYP2A interaction motif and the BRCT6. And the BRCT6 is just there to stabilize the expression. We can actually substitute it with GFP. So we're just disrupting this interaction. There are other things in that region. There are very conserved CDK sites, for example. So it's possible there's other things at play there. So it might be a little more complex than that, but we don't seem to affect the other functions of BP1. So for example, we're not affecting ATR. Obviously, the cells can replicate normally, so it's not affecting the function of BP1 in DNA replication.
Just to clarify, when you mean ATR signaling, are you talking more of the canonical ATR check one down to CDK1, or did you also look at a Ovarian kinase B activity?
No, I'm the former. So we didn't really go deep in terms of analysis of all the potential ATR signaling events. If we're expressing B6L, we're not inhibiting the ability of ATR to phosphorylate check one in response to HU challenge.
Did you kind of look at them? Because you showed kind of got that slide with the CYP2A and RPA. Did you also look at like centromeres and see if there's any association with centromeres as kind of RPA ATR is coming on to kind of regulate that process? Or
so I think taking a step back, you know, one question we're interested in is where are these lesions? What are they? And so we're looking at that right now. I think that, you know, there was a very nice set of studies that were published recently, one by that suggested that the MIDAS occurs in HR deficient cells is really linked to transcription replication conflicts. It might be overlapping or distinct sets of lesions that are taking care of by CYP2A. We don't know yet, but that's a very interesting question. The back end of the chat.
Hi, great talk, by the way. So I was curious with your data on how the overlap of CYP2 and H2X at mitosis, it wasn't 100%. So my question is, have you ever tried out giving damage at interphase and then look at mitosis whether CYP2 or TOP co-localized at the same point, which are from interphase?
So obviously, we've not done experiments where, for example, Marcus has shown that low dose radiation, you need a certain level of breaks to really fully activate the G2M checkpoint to prevent mitotic entry. So there are ways that where you can maybe play the system to create, breaks in in interphase, and then see what happens if they spill over into mitosis. So we're not really dial the system to do this. If we just irradiate with big dose, 2-5 grays, we get the G2M arrest. So we need to kind of overcome that to see mitosis. So it's not I think it's an interesting idea, but we've not really looked at that yet. What we know for sure, what we see is that. But my impression is that we will see localization in mitotic cells, because I think there's when cells enter mitosis and you get nuclear envelope breakdown, there's nothing really, there's very few, thinking out loud here, but the main reason why we don't see foci in interphase is because the complex is the CYP2A is cytoplasmic. So the second you there's a nuclear envelope breakdown, then you can access the chromatin and you can access the DNA damage sites. So
CYP2 can regulate TOPBP1 DNA damage independent function as well, which is can be an alternative role of TOP by CYP2.
I'm not sure of that, but it's a possibility,
Thank you.
I was going to follow up on the on the Fang J part, which you said you don't think is important. When I think about Fang J, it can clear ends and maybe help with the tethering. Is there any evidence there's a role for it in helping
I think maybe I kind of misspoke in saying I think there's definitely possibility for Fang J to come and play a role there in mitotic B and lesions. I think what I'm saying is I don't think Fang J is going to be the clear synthetic lethal, the protein that endows the synthetic lethality when you disrupt BRCA7/8. Definitely Fang J, and actually we actually I've done some proteomics with PVC in mitosis, FANG-J interacting with BRCA7A. So for sure it will go at the same places as so it might be a role there.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you for the questions.
Sorry now, so that Dr. Swisher share her screen.
Can you guys hear me okay?
Yeah.
Hi, Liz. Just want to introduce you and. The introduction in the meantime. So we're obviously very honored to have Dr. Elizabeth Swisher presenting today. She's joining us virtually. Liz graduated from Yale University and received her medical degree from the University of California at San Diego. She completed her residency in obstetrics and gynecology and fellowship in gynecologic oncology at Washington University in St. Louis. She's currently a professor in the Department of Obstetrics and Gynecology at University of Washington in the divisions of Gynecologic Oncology and Medical Genetics. And she's medical director of the Breast and Ovarian Cancer Prevention Program at the Seattle Cancer Care Alliance. Her lab has focused on understanding the early events of ovarian carcinogenesis and on the development of novel biomarkers of disease and prognosis, with an emphasis on the role of the homologous recombination pathway. She has made significant contributions into understanding de novo and acquired resistance to PARP inhibitors through restoration of homologous recombination proficiency via secondary BRCA or RAD51C or RAD51D mutations in tumor samples or in circulating tumor DNA, as well as via acquired loss of epigenetic silencing of HRR genes, such as acquired loss of RAD51C methylation in ovarian carcinoma. Dr. Swisher has been principal investigator on several PARP inhibitor therapeutic trials and leads the translational research for numerous other clinical trials. Her research has been funded by the NIH, the Department of Defense, the Ovarian Cancer Research Foundation, and other foundations. Liz.
Thank you so much, Panos, and everyone for the opportunity to talk today. I'm sorry I can't be there in person. So today I'm going to talk about PARP inhibitors in ovarian cancer and maximizing risk benefit. Next slide. These are my disclosures. So one of the reasons I wanted to talk about this topic is because of this somewhat infuriating developments that have been happening. You know, we spent years and years getting PARP inhibitors to patients, and now the FDA is really pushing for overall survival data in some instances when it doesn't make sense, and reducing PARP inhibitor indications, which feels like we're going in the wrong direction. And just this week, GSK voluntarily, in quotes, withdrew the indication for niraparib in non-BRCA mutated ovarian cancers in the recurrent setting for maintenance therapy. And this is based on the fact that in the cancers without germline BRCA mutations, which was 350 cases, the median overall survival was 31 months in the long-term follow-up with niraparib, the PARP inhibitor, versus 34.8 months. For patients on placebo, and that hazard ratio is 1.06 with a confidence interval that obviously crosses one easily on both sides. So this isn't even a trend. It's not what the trial was, it's a secondary outcome of the trial. So patients cross over who were in the placebo group to get PARP inhibitor. And that's really why the trial was designed for progression-free survival, not for overall survival. And if the FDA uses this SPAR to look at overall survival data, then by definition, 50% of the time, the overall survival hazard ratio will fall on the wrong side of one. So to be looking at this with a hazard ratio of 1.06 and withdrawing an indication is, you know, I think unconscionable for our patients. Next slide. But I think it does speak to the fact that we really need to define who are the patients that get the most benefit. So this is work done by Barbara Norquist, looking at 1,200 patients in GOG 218 who were all advanced stage ovarian cancer, were enrolled at the time of diagnosis as a frontline study, looking at bevacizumab, not PARP inhibitor. But in that study, we could identify that nearly 20% of patients had an either germline or somatic BRCA mutation, and then mutations in other genes that cause homologous recombination was about 7%. Next slide. And those are associated with overall survival in that we know that patients that have BRCA2 mutations have the best overall survival with advanced ovarian cancer. And patients with BRCA1 have an improved overall survival compared to those without, but not as high as BRCA2. And the other HR mutations that we had picked in advance, you know, we had to pool because they're individually rare, but those cases had similar survival, overall survival to BRCA1, it's slightly less than BRCA2. And those were all statistically significant. So the Aerial 2 trial we designed to assess rucaparib, another PARP inhibitor, efficacy in three defined subgroups. So those with BRCA mutations, those that were BRCA-like, identifying using LOH as a genomic scar for HRD, and then those that were biomarker negative. And this was a trial that was run, and next slide. And the reason that we put this trial in place was we really wanted to identify predictors of PARP inhibitor response in the BRCA wild type cases. So most of PARP inhibitor trials in ovarian cancer, use it in the maintenance setting. And so we can't really distinguish responders from non-responders because people are beginning their PARP inhibitor with non-measurable disease at that time. So Aerial 2 required measurable disease. It was monotherapy. It was not placebo controlled. It was just monotherapy for all comers. And it had the primary outcome of objective response rate. And it's really the only monotherapy trial that required pretreatment biopsies. So that has allowed us to do a lot of exploratory analyses on predictors of response to PARP inhibitor. Next slide. So the original intended outcome was to look at progression-free survival and objective response rate according to LOH in the cases that have BRCA, that don't have BRCA mutations. So the blue line is the progression-free survival in patients that have BRCA mutations on the PARP inhibitor. And this is Aerial 2 part one. Everybody had platinum-sensitive recurrent disease. So the red line is the cases that are BRCA wild type but LOH high. And you can see that those patients have a better progression-free survival on PARP inhibitor and a higher objective response rate compared to the green line, which is the cases that are BRCA wild type and LOH low. But on the other hand, the blue line is significantly better. And, you know, I was interested in looking at what are the biomarkers that kind of really more mimic that blue line as opposed to being a relatively small differential between the red and the green. Next slide. Well, so one of the first things we learned in this trial that was not inherently obvious before we started these trials was that somatic and germline BRCA mutations have identical responses to PARP inhibitor. And in this graph, this is a waterfall plot where the green bars represent patients that have germline BRCA mutations, and the light blue bars represent those that have somatic mutations. And you can see that there's really no difference between those two. And that was important for design of trials going forward. Next slide. So this is a waterfall plot limiting the patients to those that are BRCA wild type. and LOH high. So that's our genomic marker for an HRD phenotype. And you can see, so the cases on the right side are those that are responding, with the lower the line being the more profound the response. And what you can see from the this waterfall plot is that all these pink squares down at the bottom represent methylation of BRCA1 or RAS51C. And that explains a pretty large fraction of the LOH high BRCA wild type cases. They really cluster on the right side. And so those really explain a lot of the responses. Whereas the LOH high BRCA wild type that aren't responding, there's much fewer methylated cases. A second observation is that even though there's smaller numbers, the RAS51C mutations and RAS51D mutations are also clustered over here on the right with the responders. So in fact, the objective response rate was 50% for BRCA1 methylation and 75% for RAS51C methylation. Next slide. And this is a corresponding waterfall plot for those that are LOH low. And the first observation is that there's much fewer responders. Those on the right side that fall below the dashed line, there's much fewer of those cases. And even though these are LOH low, a few of the responders are still explained by methylation, which is still kind of clustered towards the right side of this graph. Next slide. So after Aerial 2 part one, which was limited to patients with platinum sensitive ovarian cancer, the sponsor expanded the enrollment to part two, which included patients that had three previous chemotherapy regimens, and they dropped the requirement for platinum sensitivity. And we also enrolled more BRCA mutation carriers, which were limited in the first part because we were really looking for biomarkers in BRCA wild type cases. Next slide. So we pulled data from Aerial 2 part one and part two. And what you can notice here is just, this is the demographics of the two parts of the study. And as I said, based on the change in enrollment criteria, part two had patients who had more exposure to prior chemotherapy with many more regimens. It had more patients that had platinum resistant and refractory disease. And it had more patients that even had non-platinum regimens because they were not, it was not limited to platinum sensitive cases. Next slide. So the objective response rate in Aerial 2 in patients that had BRCA mutations, you can see, is 80% in part one, where it was limited to platinum sensitivity, and only 31% in part two. So even for cases that had BRCA mutations, the response rate was markedly different depending on the prior chemotherapy exposure. Next slide. And another point here is that if we look at the performance of LOH as a predictor of objective response rate, if you limit that to part one, which required platinum sensitivity, LOH high patients had a statistically higher objective response rate of 29% versus 10% in LOH low cases. So LOH is functioning here as a marker of HRD in cases that are not heavily pretreated. Next slide. However, this does not work for cases that have had more platinum exposure. So in the Aerial 2 part two, where patients had at least three prior treatments, LOH does not predict objective response rate, which is really low in both LOH high and LOH low cases, period. Next slide. So this just shows essentially the same thing, but instead of objective response rate, we're looking at progression-free survival. And the case, and this is just part limited to part two. So the patients that have BRCA mutations in the blue purple line have the best progression-free survival. Whereas cases that are BRCA wild type, LOH high and LOH low have the same progression-free survival. So LOH is not differentiating the two. Next slide. So notably, those patients that have BRCA mutated tumors, if we break them down by platinum responsiveness, those patients that have platinum sensitive disease in the pink line have a better progression-free survival relative to taking the PARP inhibitor compared to those that have resistant or refractory disease. And this is not unexpected, I believe. Next slide. So what about the various RAD genes that were tested in the study? Next slide. RAD51C and RAD51D were the two, which are both ovarian cancer susceptibility genes. And all of these mutations are actually germline mutations in these that were identified here. They were all associated with an LOH high status, so our genomic marker of HRD. And all these, and of these patients, there was a high objective response rate with the partial responses that you can see in red on the right. And this is basically a, even though it's a smaller number of cases, it's an identical response rate to what we see for patients that have BRCA1 or BRCA2 mutations. Next slide. So what about ATM? So ATM was proposed initially in the initial publication in the New England Journal on Prostate Cancer as being a predictor of PARP inhibitor response. But in Aerial 2, we found really no relationship between ATM mutations, LOH status, or response. None of these patients did respond. And now I think in follow-up in even in the prostate cancer literature, ATM is not really as consistent a predictor of response. And really in the breast cancer literature, where there's a lot of patients that have ATM mutations and ATM is a driver in breast cancer, there's not been association with PARP inhibitor response. So I think our best data today is that ATM is not a predictor of PARP inhibitor response. Next paragraph. So this is the methylation data, and we broke this down. We did, in follow-up, a quantitative assay of methylation in pretreatment biopsies. So not in the archival original biopsy, but in the pretreatment biopsy, if there was high BRCA1 methylation, which is the purple line, those patients had the same progression-free survival as patients who had BRCA1 or 2 mutations in the green line, whereas low levels of methylation were similar to BRCA wild-type cases. Next slide. So we can sort of think about trying to make a combined biomarker for cases that don't have BRCA mutations. So if we combine high methylation status using a quantitative assay and combine that with having a RAD51C or D mutation, so either or, those patients have similar progression-free survival to those that have BRCA mutations. So now we're starting to develop like a predictor that's a line, you know, that mimics a line of the BRCA mutation carriers. And this is where we're trying to sort of go in terms of, can we identify a biomarker that has that, you know, massive response that we see with cases that have BRCA mutations? Next paragraph, I mean, next slide. Okay, so I'm gonna switch gears here. So that was kind of talking about trying to maximize the benefit of PARP inhibitors in patients with ovarian cancer, but I also want to talk about risks of PARP inhibitors and kind of what we're doing in that area, which is sort of a new area we're delving in. So I'm going to talk about therapy-related MDS and AML, which, you know, together we call therapy-related myeloid neoplasia or TMN. And this was a large study using Medicare data and SEER data to look at patients with all different kinds of solid tumors in the development of TMN. They linked it with Medicare claims for 165,000 adults. And they showed that the median survival from TMN is only 7 months, which is, you know, really a very poor outcome. And of all solid tumors, ovary, fallopian tube, and peritoneal had the highest risk of developing a TMN compared to other solid tumors. And it is known that TMN is associated with more treatment with leukemogenic chemotherapies, particularly platinum. And so this likely explains the high risk for ovarian cancer patients because of our treatment using platinum and even multiple regimens of platinum. Next slide. So what about PARP inhibitors? So this is a meta-analysis of randomized controlled trials of PARP inhibitors across diseases. But 43% of the trials were in ovarian cancer, and these included the larger trials that had longer follow-up. And this was almost 10,000 patients across these trials. 18 were placebo-controlled, and the median PARP inhibitor duration in the trials was 9.8 months. Next slide. And so they had 178 cases of MDS, 79 of AML, and 85% of those cases occurred in the ovarian cancer patients, which only represented 43% of the trials. But the median latency was 17.8 months, and the odds ratio across all the disease types with PARP inhibitor exposure was 2.6, which was statistically significant. But it likely really underrepresents attributable risk. If some trials were very low dose PARP inhibitor because they were trying to combine them with chemotherapy, and also follow up was quite short for some of the trials. So the incidence across the trials was 0.83%. And we often do quote patients like a 1-2% risk of TMN with PARP inhibitors. Next slide. But in fact, for patients who are long-term responders to PARP inhibitor, the TMN risk may be much higher. And particularly in patients who've had recurrent ovarian cancer, which, you know, so they've had more than one platinum regimen and they've been on a PARP inhibitor for 24 months or greater, that those patients probably have the highest TMN risk. And in Aerial 3, if we look specifically at the patients that had 24 months of a PARP inhibitor, the TMN rate was 11.4%, which is markedly higher than we ever quote patients. And in Solo 2, if you look, which was just really limited to a BRCA mutated population, the TMN risk was 8% in the PARP inhibitor treated patients in their long-term follow-up compared to 4% of controls. So these are pretty high rates. So what do we know about clonal hematopoiesis and how that might lead to TMN. So there's this phenomenon called CHIP, clonal hematopoiesis of indeterminate potential. We know that somatic mutations are acquired by all cells throughout life, and rare mutations lead to clonal expansion of hematopoietic stem cells. If additional mutations are acquired, then blood cancers may result. So clonal hematopoiesis provides a glimpse into the process of mutation and selection that likely occurs in all somatic tissues, but is easier to access in blood samples than to look at sequentially over time in various solid organs. Next paragraph. So CHIP is a non-malignant expansion of myeloid cells, and it's conventionally defined as somatic abnormalities in genes associated with myeloid neoplasia at variant allele fractions of 2% or greater. And that's sort of an arbitrary cutoff based on sequencing limitations of how many of the studies were done. So I've listed here some of the CHIP genes, the presence of CHIP increases with age. It's present in at least a third of individuals greater than 90 years old. It's been noted that P53 mutations confer a competitive advantage to hematopoietic stem and progenitor cells and are a common alteration in CHIP associated with aging and chemotherapy exposure, as well as with TMN. Next. Yeah, so P53 mutated CHIP has been looked at in cancer-free adults. And in this really like paper that I really love by Wong Wilson et al., they looked at P53 mutations at very low allele fractions. So using a more, sensitive and accurate form of sequencing than standard next gen. And they identified P53 mutations in over half of elderly in people without cancer. They demonstrated in mouse bone marrow chimeras that P53 heterozygous cells are preferentially expanded after chemotherapy. And they concluded that P53 mutations may confer a subtle competitive advantage to non-malignant clones within the normal marrow, particularly during DNA damaging chemotherapy. Next paragraph. So P53 P53 mutated CHIP is a known risk factor for the development of MDS and AML in cancer-free adults. But few prospective studies have been done. They've mostly been retrospective, looking at patients who developed MDS and AML and looking at earlier blood samples from those patients. But since P53 CHIP is so common in elderly adults, like what are the risk factors for going on to develop MDS and AML? None of these studies have been done in patients with cancer. Next paragraph.
I can answer emails.
So long-term prospective studies are lacking. Next slide. So we looked at somatic, what we were calling then somatic mosaic mutations. These are really CHIP events in PPM1D and P53. I'm going to skip the PPM1D is really highly associated with exposure to chemotherapy and probably it has less long-term risk factors in terms of developing TMN. But somatic mosaic P53 mutations in the blood were present in 1.2% of patients that had ovarian cancer without previous chemo exposure, so at the time of diagnosis, compared to 2.6% of the patients that had recurrent platinum-resistant ovarian cancer, and that did not reach statistical significance. So the patients that had P53 CHIP were also somewhat older, and there was a trend towards statistical significance in this group. Next. So then we wanted to look at the patients who had had PARP inhibitor exposure and whether or not they had, and those that developed TMN, and whether or not that they had higher diagnostic at the time of their, going on the PARP inhibitor, whether they had more CHIP at that time, and whether this might be a risk factor for them ultimately developing TMN on PARP inhibitors. So we combined data from Aerial 2, which I've already talked to you about, the monotherapy study, as well as Aerial 3, which is the randomized controlled trial of rucaparib and maintenance after second or third line platinum response. And TMN occurred in overall 2.1% of the just over 1,000 patients on these two trials that were combined. Next slide. And if we looked at risk factors across the trials for who developed TMN and who did not, the number of prior courses of chemotherapy was there was a trend towards association, but didn't reach statistical significance. What reached statistical significance was the total prior time of receiving platinum. So if you looked at the number of months of platinum exposure, that was highly related to the risk of TMN in patients that were then subsequently exposed to PARP inhibitor. And in addition, the total exposure time, because we do have patients who were on placebo as well, of PARP inhibitor was statistically significantly associated with development of TMN. Next slide. So then what we did was we kind of did a case control study where we took the patients, we took 20 patients that had TMN, where we had blood available DNA, and we picked twice the number of controls that were age matched that didn't develop TMN. And we looked at, we used a more sensitive sequencing assay and looked at P53 CHIP, as well as sort of like the standard CHIP genes, which weren't necessarily on our original sequencing panel because they're not HR related, and looked at how these associated with the development of TMN. And the only one that was really statistically associated with TMN risk was having a P53 CHIP. So the next most common CHIP is DNMT3A, which is known to be associated with age. And this was not more common in the patients that developed TMN versus not. In addition, the P53 CHIP was the one that was associated with prior platinum exposure, and the DNMT3A CHIP was associated with age, but not with platinum exposure. Next slide. So we had a few samples of patients that had TMN where we had serial samples. And these were not serial peripheral blood samples, but actual cfDNA samples. So cfDNA can be used as a surrogate for looking at CHIP because most of the DNA in cell-free DNA actually comes from the peripheral blood. And so in these patients, we looked at their P53 CHIP over time before they were diagnosed with TMN. And so this is a small number of cases, as you can see, this is just five patients, but they all had expanding P53 chip. And over the course of months, you can see that they were all increasing as opposed to being stable. Next slide. So in summary, like this is a small retrospective study that we did where we could show that TMN was associated with longer overall exposure to platinum. What we did note was that the presence of a germline or somatic BRCA1 or 2 or RAPID21C or D mutation was also associated with an increased prevalence of TMN. But why would somatic mutations, the hypothesis had been that potentially having a germline mutation in BRCA1 or 2 would increase your sensitivity to the DNA damaging agents in peripheral blood and potentially increase the risk of TMN. But why would a somatic mutation in the ovarian cancer do the same thing? Well, that was in fact because those patients that have either germline or somatic mutations are more likely to have platinum sensitive ovarian cancers, and they had longer platinum exposure because they were repetitively platinum sensitive. And if you actually looked at a multivariate analysis, it was the platinum exposure, not the BRCA1 or 2 or RAD51C and D status that put those patients at risk of TMN. But again, this is, this really needs to be done prospectively to sort out whether having a germline mutation puts you at higher risk of TMN. But our hypothesis is that it's really the platinum exposure that's driving it. So TMN were associated with having a chip variant in P53, but not with the other chip associated genes. And the P53 mutated chips were associated with a longer prior exposure to platinum chemo compared to the chips associated with other genes. So our conclusion was that P53 chips are likely associated with the development of TMN post-PARP inhibitor, and that perhaps we could be monitoring this phenomenon in patients that have recurrent ovarian cancer or prolonged PARP inhibitor exposure. Next slide. So that led us to sort of a model for how chip may develop in patients, may develop to TMN in patients with ovarian cancer. And we really want to understand what is the natural history of these P53 mutated chip in ovarian cancer survivors. What is the absolute risk of development of TMN in these women, as well as patients that have chip associated with mutations in other genes? Can we develop novel therapies for that? And can we predict, most importantly, can we predict which ovarian cancer patients will go on to develop TMN, both for those who do and do not have chip, and can we modify that progression? So if this is our sort of our model and patient has ovarian cancer, they probably have an age-related P53 mutated chip right from the get-go. And when they're in remission, that chip remains stable. But in the recurrent setting where they're retreated with platinum, that chip can expand. And then the PARP inhibitor becomes like a further expansion and transformation to the neoplasia. And so if we're monitoring patients during this time, then potentially you could withdraw a PARP inhibitor or figure out who's at highest risk. Next. So I recently got a fundable score for an R01 that we hope to be initiating this spring. And so hopefully this is a chance for collaboration, and this is to look at clonal hematopoiesis and TMN in patients with ovarian cancer. And so what the aims of this grant are to define the clonal features and dynamics of clonal hematopoiesis in ovarian cancer survivors, so to follow patients prospectively over time, and then identify the longitudinal risk of TMN and clonal cytopenias of uncertain significance for ovarian cancer survivors with and without CHIP, and define that in relationship to exposure to platinum chemo and PARP inhibitors, and essentially develop a risk model for patients that we can then use to follow patients over time. And then aim three is going to look at the trajectories of clonal evolution and the mechanisms of transformation, and that's really in collaboration with my co-investigator Sergey Dulatov, which I'm really excited about that work. Next slide. So this is a pretty ambitious proposal to enroll 2,000 individuals with primary ovarian cancer who are either on PARP inhibitor or have had recurrent ovarian cancer. And we want to also enrich for patients with ovarian cancer that have known CHIPS. So CHIPS are being identified more frequently in patients as much as ctDNA testing is being done. Unfortunately, you know, Foundation is not running, when they do their liquid biopsies and other companies are not routinely running peripheral blood as a control, but it's been well described that many of the mutations that you assume are in ctDNA are actually CHIP mutations. And so our lab is routinely runs peripheral blood as a control so that they know which are truly ctDNA mutations and which are CHIP mutations. So as we identify these patients that have CHIP, like then we would really love to get those patients in this study. And we're going to be doing serial blood samples every 6 months for 3 years in those patients that have CHIP and following them over time. Next slide. So in conclusion, we really need to maximize the risk benefit and the cost effectiveness of PARP inhibitors. And we need better biomarkers to maximize the benefit, but we also need a better understanding of TMN risk and how it develops to minimize the risk. Next slide. So I just like to acknowledge like many of my collaborators on this work, my long-term mentor, Mary Claire King, Alan D'Andrea, who we had shared, got to share a Stand Up to Cancer team for many years together, which has given me a really fun opportunity to collaborate with Dana-Farber. Next. And my lab group, which, you know, is what keeps me coming to work every day. I think that's it. I might have another slide, but I don't think so. I'm not sure. Yeah, that's it. So thank you. I'm happy to take questions.
Thank you very much, Liz. We can, are there any questions? Yes?
So if you take the high LOH BRCA wild type cases in your PARP inhibitor trials, and you have whole exome or whole genome sequencing, in principle, you could ask the question, do they look like BRCA1 deficient or BRCA2 deficient cases? Did you try to compare those, whether the BRCA2 like high LOH cases do better than the BRCA1 like?
So we have done whole genome sequencing on those cases, and we get down to small numbers when we start talking about different profiles, different mutational like profiles, but we actually don't really see a difference in those. But I'm not sure that we're really powered for that. Those patients are both doing, I mean, both of those groups are doing better. So, so I'm not sure.
Thanks. So
we haven't seen a difference to date.
Liz, I echo your frustration about the PARP inhibition withdrawal, PARP inhibitor regulatory withdrawals. So the question I have is, you showed very nicely those markers, RAD51C, RAD51D mutations, BRCA1, homozygous methylation. So the question is, now that, you know, for second line therapy, the only BRCA mutated patients can get PARP inhibitor maintenance therapy, and we're actually possibly moving towards even taking out the HRP because the PALA1 in the HRP population, the hazard ratio was more than one. So we are leaning that this patient should either get it as first line or otherwise they may not even get it at all. So that is a big problem and asks the question, how much of these alterations can mediate HRD testing detect really as HRD? Because if we end up not, and a lot of physicians end up not treating HRP patients with PARP, and if the, especially down the road, if the FDA takes them out, then we will rely on the mediated HRD testing for these patients to get PARP inhibitor even as first line. So I don't know if we have any data as to whether those RAD51C, RAD51D, BRCA homozygous, are they captured fully by the mediated HRD test?
Yeah, they are captured, but the problem is if you're gonna you kind of want to break down the, so just because if they have like a myriad HRD like indication, if that also gets withdrawn, then you are kind of left with who are really acting like the BRCA mutated patients in that setting. And that's where I say, like, you can do methylation real time, you know, you in quantitative and biopsy. And so then maybe those are the patients that you, you know, patients that retain methylation and also RAF51C and D mutation. So who are the ones that aren't going to benefit anymore? Those that have reversion mutations. So we've definitely shown that you can identify that with ctDNA. So ctDNA is not very useful for identifying, I think, sensitivity, but it actually is pretty useful for identifying resistance. So I think that you could sort of, you know, have an algorithm where, okay, they're in the recurrent setting and maybe the risk of PARP inhibitors is higher from a TMN risk and maybe the response is lower, but if they have high levels of methylation or they have like a RAF51C or D, or I would honestly throw in POLB2 as well, mutation, and they don't have a reversion, then they should be like, I mean, they should be considered. And when we say we, you know, we can use all kinds of things off label. So I think you just have to use, you just have to take the patients who are going to get the most benefit. My concern is that if we say we're going to like not know who to treat in the recurrent setting, then the reflex is going to be, we're just going to treat everybody in the upfront setting since that's the only place to treat them. And I think that goes back to this like non-personalized medicine, whereas we have this PARP inhibitors being this incredible, like, you know, almost like the flagship for synthetic lethality. And then we're going to basically treat everybody and not those that have like an actual inherent sensitivity. It doesn't make any sense to me, you know. So I think that we should be using biomarkers to predict who gets it. And we shouldn't just like sort of reflexively say, oh, they're not going to let us treat them later, so we should use it all up front and treat everybody. Because I think that we can differentiate, you know, who should get Bev, who should get PARP inhibitor in the upfront setting, and who should potentially get a combination.
Absolutely.
Alan. Yeah, hi Liz. It's Alan.
Hi, Alan.
Hi there. Good morning. All right, so this trial that you proposed, 2,000 patients, and trying to maybe predict the TMN, I'm wondering if some patients who have routine PARP inhibitor, some of them might have prolonged period of bone marrow aplasia or strong neutropenia in response, just kind of to routine levels. And I'm wondering if those individuals might have an underlying germline HR defect that we didn't know about that maybe predisposed to the ovarian cancer in the first place. I'm just wondering if that would be something that you might want to measure or just.
Yeah, for sure. You know, for sure. And we would love to get referrals from like hematology clinics who are seeing patients with cytopenia. Who have ovarian cancer. You know, we refer patients and it's just, you know, it's just keeping it front and center, you know, for people to think about referring patients that have these issues. But we're going to really try to work through the advocacy organizations and have patients self-refer because we definitely want to access these patients that have these kinds of cytopenias because they're probably like, a higher yield in terms of being somewhere on the spectrum of risk.
And Jeff?
Yeah, no, Liz, thanks for that great talk. So I was very struck by your bullet in your Arial 2 study that it was the only study where every patient actually had a pretreatment biopsy. And at least I thought I saw that bullet on that slide. But I was just wondering if you considered at all, with all the genomics that you've done, thinking about a functional biomarker here for who might be the best patients to get a PARP inhibitor, especially in the recurrent setting. And, you know, whether or not, if you've got biopsies available, whether we should be looking, say, at a RAT51 assay, some functional biomarker of homologous recombination that would complement all the genomics and methylation work that you've done.
Or CB2A. Expression of truth.
Yeah, so these biopsies, okay, so it's not the only study that had pretreatment biopsies, but it's the only monotherapy study. So a lot of the now the combination studies, you know, the more innovative studies are requiring biopsies, but then they're you know, they're getting combinations. So it's kind of the cleanest just from a pure monotherapy standpoint. So those biopsies were all formalin fixed biopsies. So it kind of limits our ability to do like, you know, functional testing in that requires live cells. So people are trying to develop that Rad51 foci assay in formalin fixed FFPE, but I have not been convinced. I've reviewed even a few recent papers. Like it's not yeah, it's challenging. And so but what so and then the biopsies are pretty limited, like because they're these were needle biopsies, and so they were used primarily for the primary objectives of the study, and they were used for the methylation work, and there's not like much residual. So one of the things that I think people are looking at is can you use AI just of the pathology? You know, people are doing that for looking at MSI phenotype. Could you do that even from a functional like HRD perspective, you know, which doesn't require potentially live cells. So there's still a lot of exploratory work going, but unfortunately they're not, you know, most of those biopsies have been used up at this point, and we didn't have fresh biopsies either.
Very well. Thank you so much, Liz, again.
Thank you, guys.
Now it is my pleasure to introduce Dr. Filipa Lynce. Filipa received her medical degree from the Universidad Nova de Lisboa, Portugal, and completed her residency in internal medicine and fellowship in hematology and medical oncology at MedStar Washington Hospital Center at Georgetown University Hospital in Washington, D.C., where she subsequently served as the institutional PI for Alliance and the co-PI for the National Capital Area Minority Underserved NCI Community Oncology Research Program. In 2020, we were fortunate that she joined Dana-Farber Cancer Institute Breast Oncology Center, where she's currently the director of the Inflammatory Breast Center and assistant professor of medicine at Harvard Medical School and the clinical representative of the Breast Oncology Program at the Center for BRCA and Related Genes. Her research focuses on inflammatory breast cancer, triple-negative breast cancer, BRCA-associated breast cancers, and novel therapies in the treatment of breast cancer. Filipa?
Thank you very much. Can you all hear me well? So I'd like to start by thanking the organization for inviting me to be here today. And in the next 30 minutes, I plan to review with you advances in the systemic treatment of BRCA1 and 2 and PALB2-associated breast cancer. And I hope that you'll agree that this is a nice segue of the wonderful talk that we just listened to. Okay, so here are my disclosures, and here is the outline of what I will cover. We'll look at some unique clinical pathologic features of BRCA1 and 2 associated breast cancer, use of PARP inhibitors in BRCA1 and 2 germline associated breast cancer and beyond those. What is the role of an old drug, platinum, in BRCA1 and 2 associated breast cancer? We'll look at some novel combinations, and at the end, we'll look as well at the PARP1 selective inhibitors. So in order to get a sense of how many patients really are affected with these, we can look at the estimated prevalence and lifetime absolute risk of breast cancer for those affected with these pathogenic variants. And many studies have shown us that the aggregate prevalence of pathogenic variants in breast cancer predisposition genes is estimated at 10 to 10% among women with breast cancer, which translates into a lifetime absolute risk of about 57 to 66% in BRCA1 carriers, and a little bit lower than that for those with a BRCA2 mutation, which is very high compared to the 9% estimate in general population. Now, most of these risks, most of these studies have included high-risk patient populations, often patients that have family history of breast or ovarian cancer and that are diagnosed at a younger age. So when we look at the carriers, is a US-based consortium that includes different population and family studies. And here in this manuscript that was published in New England just last year, they looked at their population studies and they estimated that the prevalence of pathogenic variants in 12 known breast cancer predisposition genes is probably a little bit lower than what has been estimated in the past in about 5% among cases, which translates into a lifetime absolute risk of breast cancer of about 50%, both in BRCA1 and BRCA2, although with an earlier onset for those with a BRCA1 mutation. So there are differences as well in terms of the type of breast cancer that it's commonly developed in patients with a BRCA1 or BRCA2 mutations. Those with a BRCA1 commonly develop triple negative breast cancers, which are basal light, high tumor grade, while those with BRCA2 tumors more commonly develop estrogen receptor positive breast cancers. And the distribution of breast cancer actually follows what we see in non-BRCA associated breast cancers. Now, if we focus our attention in ER-positive breast cancers in germline BRCA carriers, and we compare those to sporadic tumors, the ones on BRCA carriers are often diagnosed at a younger age. They present with higher nuclear grade and lower estrogen receptor and progesterone receptor expression, and they have higher risk on genomic tests. And this has been one of the topics of interest to us. We are currently looking at a cohort of tumors through a grants funded by BCRF, PI Dr. Judy Garber, where we are trying to understand if these tumors are mainly driven by the ER pathway or the homologous recombination repair pathway. And this is of particular clinical relevance when we have different options for these patients. We have PARP inhibitors, we have CDK4/6 inhibitors, and it's important to know what is the pathway that these tumors rely on. So this timeline represents the progress made in the management of BRCA1 and 2 associated breast cancers over the last 30 years. We see that it took about 10 years from the cloning of BRCA1 and BRCA2 to the presentation of two seminal manuscripts that show us how BRCA1 and BRCA2 deficient tumor cells are hypersensitive to PARP inhibition. And this was followed by the first phase 1 trials of PARP inhibition. We saw as well that the Supreme Court ruling against myriad patents really brought more companies into genetic testing, leading or helping our patients to have more patients having access to genetic testing at a lower cost. This was then followed by the presentation of the results of two important trials of the PARP inhibition in a metastatic setting that led to the approval of PARP inhibitors for these patients, followed by knowledge of the role of PARP inhibitors beyond germline BRCA mutations. We saw then the role of olaparib in the early stage setting that also led to the approval of olaparib in this setting. And very excitingly, we saw the launch of the first phase 1 trial with PARP1 selective inhibitors. So here you can see the 5 PARP inhibitors that are currently under development. Only 2 so far have been approved for the use in patients with breast cancer, olaparib and talazoparib. What this table wants to show you is that not all PARP inhibitors are created equal. There are some biochemical differences and as well in terms of the relative PARP trapping potency. However, to date, we haven't seen any data to show that this actually reflects into different clinical activity. So I'm going to guide you through a few slides on that showed the benefit of olaparib for patients with metastatic breast cancer. But I think that if we want to summarize these slides in a short message, is that PARP inhibition, when compared to chemotherapy of physician's choice and non-platinum containing regimens, was associated with a statistically significant improvement in progression-free survival, overall response rates, and quality of life, not in overall survival. And the benefit was seen equally on triple negative breast cancer and ER positive breast cancers as well. So here is Olympia. This was the first of these landmark studies, a randomized phase 3 open label study that included patients with metastatic HER2 negative breast cancer, and patients were randomized on a 2-to-1 ratio to receive olaparib or physician's choice chemotherapy with a primary endpoint of progression-free survival. Here are the clinical outcomes. You can see on the left the Kaplan-Meier curves showing a statistically significant improvement in progression-free survival with the use of olaparib compared to standard therapy. The progression-free survival with olaparib, the mean progression-free survival was 7 compared to 4.2 months with a hazard ratio of 0.58. However, we did not see an improvement in overall survival. Now, in terms of the symptoms most commonly experienced by patients treated with olaparib, these are mainly gastrointestinal, fatigue, headache, although those are mainly grade 1 and 2. When it comes to hematological toxicity, patients treated with olaparib more often experience anemia, while patients treated with standard chemotherapy more often experience neutropenia. The results of Olympiad led to the FDA and EMA approval, and it's now an option for our patients. The second trial that I want to show you in a very similar setting is the BRCA study that's looked at the role of talazoparib in patients with metastatic disease. This, again, was a phase 3 international open-label study. Patients were randomized in a 2-to-1 ratio to receive talazoparib or chemotherapy treatment of physician's choice, with a primary endpoint of progression-free survival. And here are the clinical outcomes, very similar to what I showed you with olaparib. There was a benefit in progression-free survival with the use of talazoparib compared to chemotherapy of physician's choice, with a very similar hazard ratio of 0.54. And in terms of overall survival, I think that this was disappointing for many of us that were hoping that the stronger PARP trapping activity seen preclinically with talazoparib could perhaps translate into better clinical outcomes, but that was not the case. The results of this study led as well to the approval of talazoparib, both by the American and European agencies. So what do we know about the role of PARP inhibitors in the early stage setting? So what we know came from the Olympia trial. This was a large phase three global randomized double-blinded study that enrolled patients with stage 2 or stage 3 breast cancer that had hormone receptor positive or triple negative breast cancer and had a germline pathogenic or likely pathogenic BRCA1 and 2 mutation. Patients were randomized in a 1-to-1 ratio to receive olaparib or placebo for 1 year. And what I wanted to point out here is that although patients with triple negative breast cancer and hormone receptor positive breast cancer were allowed it on study, the patients that had hormone receptor positive had a particular high risk disease. So if they were treated with neoadjuvant chemotherapy, they were required not to have achieved a PAT-CR or to have a CPS and EG score of 3 or higher. And I include it here as this is a score that clinically we often don't use. But if these patients were treated in the adjuvant setting, it was required that they had at least 4 positive lymph nodes. So perhaps not surprising, when we look at the patient characteristics that participated in this trial, almost three-quarters of the patients had a BRCA1 mutation and had triple-negative breast cancer. That's perhaps, or at least in part, reflects the different eligibility criteria. In terms of toxicity, the side effects were similar to what we expected with olaparib, what we learned from the metastatic trials. There were no new safety signals. And in terms of, and what we learned from the previous talk, an event of interest to all of us that it's the development of MDS or AML, you can see that at a medium of 3.5 years of follow-up, there were only 5 events, 2 in the olaparib arm and 3 in the placebo arm. But perhaps this reflects at least in part that these patients have less exposure to platinum than patients treated for ovarian cancer. Oops. I'll show you now here the primary endpoint that was invasive disease-free survival. You can see that the addition of olaparib to standard treatment was associated with an improvement of 8.8% in terms of the 3-year invasive disease-free survival with a hazard ratio of 0.58. We saw similar results in terms of distant disease-free survival again with a hazard ratio of 0.57. At time that these results were reported last year, there was no statistically significant difference in terms of overall survival. However, we learned earlier this year when we were presented with the second overall survival interim analysis that there was a 3.8% improvement in overall survival at 36 months, and this was statistically significant. After these results were presented, we saw the approval of olaparib for patients with early stage breast cancer considered at a higher risk. And we saw the approval both by the American and European agencies. So next, I'd like to talk about what we know about the role of PARP inhibitors beyond germline BRCA1 and BRCA2. And two important trials, address this question. The first one is the TBCRC-048. This was a trial where patients with metastatic breast cancer were allowed to participate, and they received olaparib as monotherapy. The primary objective was overall response rate. And I show you here at the bottom of the slide the genes alterations that the patient had to have in order to be allowed to participate on the trial. Now, patients could go on either cohort 1 if they had a germline mutation in any of these genes, or on cohort 2 if they had a somatic mutation. For this cohort 2, somatic BRCA1 or BRCA2 mutations were allowed it as long as they were germline BRCA negative. So at the time that the results were presented, 53 patients had already participated on this trial with an even distribution between cohort 1 and cohort 2. Of interest, more than 3/4 of these patients had hormone receptor positive breast cancer. If we look by cohort, you can see that the gene alteration or the gene that was the top of inclusion in terms of the germline cohort was PALB2, followed by CHEK2 and ATM, while in the somatic cohort, more than half of the patients had a somatic mutation either on BRCA1 or BRCA2. And here are the results. In terms of overall response rate, it was about 30% on both cohorts, with 9 patients experiencing a partial response on cohort 1 and 8 patients experiencing a partial response on cohort 2. However, if we look by specific genes, you can see that in the cohort 1, so the germline cohort, all the patients that had a response had a germline PALB2 mutation. On cohort 2, the somatic cohort, all the patients that had a response had a somatic BRCA1 or BRCA2 mutation, and this represented 50% of the patients enrolled. And for those patients that were enrolled with an ATM or CHEK2 alteration, none of these patients had a response. Now, these results were very intriguing. I think that we need to be careful just because the sample size was so small, but something for sure to continue to investigate. And that's what was done on this second trial, where instead of olaparib, talazoparib was used. This was recently published in Nature Cancer. This was a smaller study with 20 patients that included not only breast cancer, but other solid tumors, as you can see here. And you can see as well that in terms of mutations, again, there were 6 patients enrolled with a germline PALB2 mutation. Now, the numbers in terms of overall response rate are very similar to what I just show you with TBCRC-048, so an overall response rate of 31%. However, you can see here in the bottom that 3/4 of the responders had a germline PALB2 mutation and had breast cancer. And the efficacy, the activity of olaparib continues to be investigated in TBCRC-048 for these patients with PALB2 mutations, and hopefully we'll hear more results soon. What about the role of platinums in BRCA1 and 2 associated breast cancer? So these old drugs, carboplatin, cisplatin, we know that they are DNA damaging chemotherapies as well. And so there might be a benefit of these agents in germline BRCA1 and 2 associated breast cancer. So this is a question that the TNT trial tried to answer. Now, this was a large randomized trial that included triple negative breast cancer and selected for BRCA mutations that were candidates for first line therapy. And patients were randomized to receive carboplatin or a taxane. Now there was, although the overall response, the primary endpoint was overall response rate in the unselected population, there was a pre-specified protocol-enabled biomarker treatment interaction analysis that allowed us to look at results in the germline BRCA group and BRCA subgroups. So here are the results in the overall population. There was no difference between carboplatin and those taxane in terms of the overall response rate. However, when you look at those that had a germline BRCA1 and 2 mutation, you see that the use of carboplatin was associated with a doubling in the overall response rates when compared to those taxane carboplatin here represented in orange and those taxane represented in green. However, when they looked at those with tumor BRCA1 or 2 mutation, there was a numerical superiority for the use of the carboplatin compared to those taxane that did not achieve statistically significance. What about in the early stage setting? So we have seen some conflicting data coming from different trials. Here I'm just highlighting two trials. One is the GPAR-60 trial that looked at a neoadjuvant regimen with an anthracycline and a taxane and asked the question whether adding carboplatin would lead to increased clinical outcomes. And you see here on the bottom that the patients with wild-type BRCA-associated breast cancer that did not receive carboplatin, and this is the curve in the dark green, they did worse than those with BRCA wild-type that received carboplatin, and that is the curve in orange. However, when they looked at those that had a BRCA1 or 2 germline mutation, they found out, and those are represented in the light green and the gray, they realized that there was no difference with the addition of carboplatin. Again, these were small numbers, but this is intriguing results. Another study, the TBCRC-031 or the INFORM trial that focused specifically on patients with known BRCA mutations, these patients were randomized to receive either cisplatin or an anthracycline-containing regimen in the neoadjuvant setting. And what you can see here at the bottom is that the patients treated with cisplatin represented in blue had in fact a lower pathological complete response rate than those treated with an anthracycline containing regimen. So it's still unclear at this time what is the role of carboplatin on BRCA associated tumors with these discording results in the metastatic and in the early stage setting. Now, this is a topic for sure that it's important to learn more about it. Just because carboplatin is currently part of the treatment of triple negative breast cancer, irrespective of the BRCA status. So our patients are receiving carboplatin or most of them as part of a neoadjuvant regimen that was demonstrated its benefit in the KEYNOTE-522. And many of them are as well receiving carboplatin in the metastatic setting. So whether prior exposure to PARP inhibitors might impact response to a platinum or vice versa, it's important to continue to learn more about it. So I'll show you here a case. This was a BRCA1, a patient that had a BRCA1 mutation, and she developed a triple negative breast cancer that was a T2N0. She received a neoadjuvant containing regimen with an anthracycline and a taxane. And this was followed by mastectomy and adjuvant radiation. Unfortunately, she ended up developing a recurrence. And at the time that she developed a recurrence, a PDX model was established that showed an alteration in RAS7 function. And you can see here the results of that model. On the left, you see that the model was sensitive to cisplatin, which is illustrated by the two doses of cisplatin on day one and day 34, here illustrated with a dark arrow, while on the right, we see that this model was not sensitive to a PARP inhibitor. This is somehow translated or reflected on what happened clinically. this patient was enrolled in a clinical trial with cisplatin and a PARP inhibitor where she experienced a partial response, but when cisplatin was dropped and patient was continued on olaparib as monotherapy, we saw a progression of her disease. Now, many mechanisms of PARP inhibitor resistance have been described. We heard already about many of them earlier today, and we will continue to hear. Of those, the reversion mutations have been more and more identified as possibly the cause of resistance to PARP inhibitors. But I think it's important that we continue to do work in this field, as depending on the mechanisms of PARP inhibitor resistance, that might predict response to platinum or actually still sensitivity to platinum. And Jeff and I have been working for a while on a concept that tries to answer this question in a very pragmatic way. We have data from the ovarian cancer world, and we feel very jealous about it, where it shows that the response rates to PARP inhibitors as monotherapy depends on whether a patient is platinum sensitive, resistant, or refractory. And this study in particular was done with olaparib as monotherapy. However, patients who progressed on platinum were excluded from the Olympiad and then BRCA trial. So we really are lacking this data in breast cancer. So I think that it was a major improvement to have PARP inhibitors approved for breast cancer, both in the metastatic setting and the early stage setting. I think that we can still do more, in particular in the metastatic setting, where we all hope to have more durable responses for our patients. And here I just show you in this cartoon some of the combinations that are currently being explored with PARP inhibitors in breast cancer. And those include radiation therapy, CDK inhibitors, immune checkpoint inhibitors, ATR inhibitors, platinum agents, epigenetic drugs, nucleoside analogs, and many different antibody drug conjugates. And I just highlight here some of the examples of ongoing or recently completed clinical trials, and those here is the ones that many of us have been deeply involved in these trials. I'm going to show you just an example, a few slides on some of these. One is the Talavi study that was a trial that I developed and led when I was at Georgetown that has now completed enrollment. As you can see, this is a trial that is heavy in correlative, so all patients underwent a pretreatment biopsy, a biopsy after 1 month of talazoparib as monotherapy, and then a third biopsy after 1 month on the combination therapy. So we are currently looking at correlatives both at the DNA and protein level, work that is being done out, under our breast score. And although I still don't have results to show you here today, I think that one of the reasons why this is going to be so important, even if it's a small trial, is because we have seen some data from trials that looked at PARP inhibitors with immunotherapy, but then as single arm studies that reported an overall response rate of about 60% and a median PFS of 8 months. But if you put head to head the results, and here just illustrated one, the Mediola, but there are others. If you put head to head with the Olympia trial, which we should not do it because these are different patient populations, and namely in terms of a prior exposure to platinum or prior lines of therapy. But I think that it's tempting to, by comparing the overall response rate and the progression-free survival, to ask ourselves how much the checkpoint inhibitor is really adding to the benefit that we would see with PARP inhibition alone. So for sure, what we need are the results of randomized trials, and a randomized trial led by Pat LoRusso through ETCTN has completed enrollments, and we eagerly expect the results of that trial. Another trial that I wanted to tell you about is sapatilabine and olaparib that was developed based on preclinical work done here, initially led by Sarah Tolaney. And this trial that was planned to be a phase one with expansion cohort had to close prematurely due to hematological toxicity. However, what I wanted to show you from these 10 patients is that we did see three exceptional responders. This was the data cutoff of earlier this year, I can tell you that two of these patients are still on study, and we were fortunate to collect serial ctDNA on all these patients. And we are looking at the results right now as well, but I can tell you that for most of these patients, we could anticipate progression based on what we saw on the ctDNA results. So finally, of course, we could not give this talk without talking about Pol Theta inhibition. The homologous recombinant deficient cells are dependent on MMEJ that is mediated by POLQ, and PARP1 facilitates recruitment of POLQ to sites of DNA damage. So POLQ is a target in HR repair deficient cells and has been an area of interest for many in this room. And recent data suggests that POLQ inhibition may suppress the emergence of BRCA reversion mutations that can emerge during PARP inhibitor resistance. So here is one of the trials that it's ongoing, looking at POLQ inhibitors. This one is led by Artios, looking at ART4215. This drug in particular inhibits the polymerase domain. And what you can see here on part B3, that it's a cohort that it's specifically designed for breast cancer. And I think that this is the question that we need to see answer is this will be a randomization, asking whether adding the ART4215 makes a difference combined with talazoparib compared to talazoparib alone. I wanted to show you as well this concept that has been approved by CTAP, a project led by Dr. Jeff Shapiro and Alan Andrea, that it's looking at the role of an old antibiotic, novobiocin, that inhibits the helicase domain, so different somehow from the prior drug that has a similar design, and will be asking the question as well of whether combining novobiocin and talazoparib, we are going to see efficacy in these patients. And there will be a cohort as well for patients with breast cancer. So finally, just a few words on PARP1 selective inhibitors. Only PARP1 inhibition trapping is required for synthetic lethality in homologous recombination repair deficient settings. And preclinically, PARP2 is essential for erythropoiesis. So it seems to us that this is a non-brainer and the drug that we have been waiting for in order to allow better tolerability and in order to allow as well better combination strategies. So this is the PETRA study, a first-in-human study looking at AZD5305, a PARP1 selective inhibitor being developed by AZ that is looking at different levels of AZD5305. And what I wanted to show you here is data presented by Team Yap at ASPR earlier this year. At the time of the data cutoff in February 2022, 61 patients had already been dosed. We can see here that about one third of those patients had breast cancer. But what I wanted to highlight here is that most of the patients had prior exposure to PARP inhibitors and or platinum. So this is very interesting data. When we look at AZD5305 comparing to other four PARP inhibitors, we see that there is improved toxicity profile, both in terms of gastrointestinal toxicity, but also in terms of hematological toxicity. And very importantly, we saw a small number of patients that require dose reductions or discontinuation due to treatment emergent adverse events. So just a glance of the results. When they had 40 evaluable patients, there were 10 PRs, 11 stable diseases. But perhaps more important than that is that they saw responses across different doses, across different tumor types, with breast cancer here illustrated in gray, across mutation types, but also independent of prior PARP inhibition use. So I think that these results are very exciting, and we all are waiting to see AZD5305 move and other PARP1 selective inhibitors move forward in the clinic. So I'll finish with this slide of the timeline. I think that we have made great progress, and I can't wait to see what we'll be doing in the next 30 years. I leave you with a few unanswered questions that perhaps will direct as well some of our future work. So can we cure small node negative BRCA1 and 2 and PALB2 associated breast cancer without chemotherapy? And I think that when the prior talk was talking about personalized medicine and not having a one size fits all, but really delivering the best treatment for each patient, this is what our patients are looking for. Instead of giving chemotherapy, regardless of some specific information, can we cure these patients without ever needing chemotherapy? Second, what is the best agent after progression on PARP inhibitors? We all have these patients in the clinic and we are struggling to decide what is the best next step. And then what is the optimal agent to combine with PARP inhibitors or PARP1 selective inhibitors to achieve more durable responses with acceptable tolerability? Finally, I just wanted to thank the Center for BRCA and Related Genes team. Here highlighted those that have a leadership role, but many others who we have had the pleasure of collaborating and learning with for the last 2 years, with monthly meetings, with brainstorming about new ideas. So this has been a lot of fun. I've learned a lot, and I think that we have started and conducted important work for our patients. So thank you very much.
Really great talk, Filipa. Any questions?
Yes, really nice talk. I'm wondering if it will be worth revisiting the expanded use of the PARP1 selective inhibitors in patients that have mutations in genes such as ATM and others. And I bring that up for a reason. In the last talk from Liz, we said that there really wasn't efficacy there. And this would be predicted from preclinical data that there'd be a more narrow therapeutic window for those type of genes as opposed to PALB2, BRCA1, or BRCA2. But if you can increase the dose of the PARP1 selective, can you get it to a point where now these tumors, which have more moderate reductions in HR, now start to respond?
I totally agree. And I think that will be one of the directions where the field will move forward.
Thank you.